You'll spend 30 years of your life unconscious, snoring, drooling, and dreaming your best years away. But what if you never closed your eyes again? No naps, no dozing off, just endless waking hours and infinite possibilities. Could you unlock superhuman potential, or would your mind and body begin to shatter? In this episode of the Infographic Show, we're exploring what a life without sleep really does to the human body. Day 1. On day 1 without sleep, your body will be holding up just fine. If you're like most people, you're coming off a decent 6 to 8 hours the night before. As the day wears on, you might feel a little tired, but overall everything is normal. Your appetite will be normal, your mood will be just your usual, and your energy levels will be fine. It's green lights across the board. But that won't last. Your brain likes routine, which is why whether you're a night owl or the early to bed, early to rise type, you tend to start feeling sleepy around the same time each day. For most people, this happens between 9 and 11 p.m. This is caused by your brain basically deciding that you need to shut down for maintenance. But why? It all comes down to keeping that powerful brain of yours in top shape. With great power comes great responsibility, and with great brain power comes a serious need for rest. A good night's sleep isn't just relaxing, it's when your brain performs essential maintenance. Think of it as a nightly tune-up. It's the brain's way of keeping all those cerebral cylinders firing smoothly. It needs this time to repair and reinforce the neural pathways that support your ability to think, remember, and focus. And just like the road crews do their heaviest work at night to avoid traffic, your brain waits until you're asleep when mental traffic is at its lowest. With less traffic, there's less interruptions to the maintenance process and less risk of it going wrong. However, the brain is also building up new neural pathways you may have started forming via experiences in the daytime. This is critical for mental health and the formation of new memories, which can seal away critical knowledge like newly learned skills. If you have spent sleepless nights studying during college and high school, you know that you probably did worse on the test the next day than if you had simply gotten a good night's sleep. And that's because you are denying your brain the ability to codify all that information you just downloaded. Then there's the necessary removal of certain toxins produced in the brain by regular activity. Much like your muscles build up lactic acid when you exercise, the byproducts of the chemical interactions in your brain also build up. During sleep, new studies show that the brain detoxifies from these byproducts, thus keeping itself healthy. But it's not just about the brain. Sleep affects almost everything in your body in ways scientists still don't fully understand. What they do know is that without sleep, you are basically slowly dying. Lack of sleep is directly tied to increase in cardiovascular disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, depression, and obesity. The good news is that you need a chronic lack of sleep to have a severe health effect, and the brain will typically shut down against your will if it needs to before it happens. But let's look at what day one with no sleep really looks like. Sometime in the evening or whenever your preferred time for sleep is, you're going to get hit with a wall of fatigue. This is due to the brain starting its expected sleep sequence, which includes dumping melatonin. This sleep chemical is used to regulate your sleep-wake cycle and is produced by the pineal gland. Typically, once the brain detects that it is getting dark, it starts the production of melatonin in order to ease it into a sleep-ready state. However, new research suggests that melatonin, like sleep itself, does more than just help you rest. It may also play a key role in supporting your immune system. Unless you actively fight it, your natural sleep cycle will likely have you snoozing eventually. However, there can be certain conditions that prevent this from happening, such as the use of stimulants, some brain injuries, and withdrawal symptoms. During World War II, German soldiers famously used stimulants to keep themselves awake for over 36 hours at a time. Their use is directly credited with the stunning speed of their attack into France at the start of the war. Brain injuries, some psychological trauma, and withdrawals can all also interrupt your ability to sleep. In these cases, either the brain doesn't enter a natural sleep cycle or it's disrupted. Alcohol and drug withdrawals can actively prevent sleep by stimulating the central nervous system directly. During withdrawals, your brain is caught between its regular nighttime shutdown procedure and the stimulation of the central nervous system, which fights against the desire to sleep. A similar thing happens to those suffering from restless leg syndrome, as they are overcome with a need to expend energy by moving or shaking their legs. But if you have ever had a restless leg, then you know it's impossible to actually rid yourself of the feeling of excess energy. It's a horribly uncomfortable condition that can completely override the need for sleep no matter how tired you are. Modern drugs to aid both restless legs and withdrawals focus on calming the central nervous system's response that triggers the inability to sleep, albeit with very mixed results. Extreme withdrawals can completely overpower even the best drugs, or sufferers may only find minutes to an hour or two of relief. Restless legs can be just as disruptive, and common drugs used to treat it, like Requip or Ropinirole, can actually make the problem worse by causing augmentation of symptoms to other limbs. Without being able to sleep, your thinking becomes slightly foggy. However, you're still on day one, and it's not unheard of for people to go 30 hours with no sleep before having significant mental effects. You will notice that your reactions are slower than normal, and your energy levels plummet as your brain is stuck in sleep mode during the nighttime hours. In sleep mode, your brain also produces fewer endorphins and natural opioids, the chemicals that help regulate pain and boost your mood. So, not only are you restless, but your mood starts to dip as well. And while things are still manageable, the worst is yet to come. Day 2. The start of day 2 is going to be rough but manageable. People still find that they're able to hold down a job even despite a day of no sleep. Your brain and your body are still cruising on energy reserves from the previous day. As the sun begins to rise, your brain turns to daytime operations mode, helping you feel a little bit better. That's due to the brain exiting sleep mode and increasing production of endorphins and natural opioids, slightly lifting mood and even increasing energy. One thing you're gonna notice, though, is low appetite. Initially, your body's appetite-regulating hormones such as leptin and ghrelin are disrupted, which can lead to a lack of appetite. However, it doesn't take long for the disruption to lead to a reverse effect, an overproduction of ghrelin, which stimulates hunger, and underproduction of leptin, which helps the brain know the stomach's full. On day 2, though, you're probably feeling pretty sluggish, and your body is gonna go slower than usual. This can lead to you losing your appetite. However, eventually the brain tries to fight the low energy state it finds itself in by forcing you to make bad food choices. High-calorie foods become more attractive as the brain desperately seeks sources of energy. And this is why people with long-term disrupted sleep cycles are at a serious risk for obesity. As your day continues, you'll start to find yourself losing interest in things, even things that you normally are passionate about. This feeling will only get worse until you're left in a zombie-like state, completely disconnected from the world and your own life. Day 3. On day 3 of no sleep, things are starting to become severe. Your appetite is still suffering, but you're likely experiencing cravings for high-calorie foods like sweets and soda. Your body is lacking energy, and your brain is turning to the best source of energy available, high-calorie counts. But as you bite into that gas station cupcake, you'll realize that it tastes duller than usual. In fact, anything that you eat at this point seems to have little flavor. That's due to the depression of certain brain systems, such as the one responsible for telling you how things taste. Without a chance to refresh, your brain is also producing less feel-good chemicals, such as serotonin and endorphins, leading to a mood crash. The crash is so severe by day 3 that it directly affects things you would normally enjoy. You turn on your favorite TV show and it's just not as enjoyable, barely keeping your attention. Your favorite video game fails to keep you entertained, and sex with a partner is either severely affected or simply not an option as your sex drive plummets. Life begins to lose meaning, and the hours seem to run into each other. By this point, you're probably too severely affected to do most work. Holding down a day job is all but impossible. If your job requires any sort of heavy physical effort or dealing with customers, you are likely not able to complete it at all. Energy levels are critically low. Maybe you could bench press 200 pounds before your insomnia, but now you're struggling just to lift weights into place on the barbell. Due to a depression in the production of feel-good chemicals, you're going to be entering a medical condition known as anhedonia. This is the inability to feel pleasure in normally pleasurable activities, meaning your mood is going to flatten. Things that brought you joy before don't do it anymore, and the social effects can be severe. You appear flat to people, your emotions severely impacted to express neither joy nor anger. Even things like empathy can be difficult to process for people in this state of sleeplessness, which can explain why soldiers who use stimulants can be prone to committing acts of extreme violence. As night comes, you start to feel increasing amounts of stress. Your brain is fighting itself, the desire to sleep versus an inability to do so. This can lead to wild mood swings and extreme depression. With production of natural opioids depressed, small aches and pains can be magnified, causing further discomfort that makes sleep impossible. Your brain is careening straight into the danger zone, but it has a ways to go yet. Day 4. Day 4 is gonna be extremely unpleasant. Your hormone imbalances means that your mood swings are now severe, though many individuals simply find that the only mood they're stuck in is a deep depression. Toxins are building up in your brain and further interfering with the ability to produce the necessary mood-regulating chemicals and hormones that you need to feel normal. This is going to be made worse by a lack of proper diet. You're probably too exhausted at this point to feel real hunger, but without ingesting sources of energy, you are just compounding your problems. There's no raw materials for your brain to build necessary chemicals from, throwing you into a vicious self-defeating cycle unless you force yourself to eat. And if you do, prepare for stomach pains and extreme nausea, because your stomach simply isn't prepared to deal with large amounts of food. It's recommended you take a page out of Spain's playbook and take meals slowly, eating little by little over a long course of time to let your stomach adjust. When you put food in, there is only one end result – poop. And you can forget about yours being solid. At this stage, your body is so out of whack that it is not digesting food properly, and that means you're going to be dealing with the Hershey squirts. From this day on, be aware of any fart that creeps up on you, because there's a good chance it's bringing along a very runny guest. And with your body so exhausted, sphincter control isn't going to be at the top of your capabilities list. The combination of mud butt and a loose sphincter means you better be close to the bathroom, or at least keep your laundry routine tight. If not, you're going to end up carrying a fresh cup of the devil's coffee in your pants when you least expect it. The physical exhaustion is so severe at this point that even ordinary activities like walking are going to take a serious toll. In fact, by now, you're probably more stumbling than walking. And exhaustion, combined with a reduced motor control, means you're at a real risk of a bad fall. Even a standing height fall can kill you. So this isn't about embarrassing yourself in public. And if you're walking out in public, you've got harsh daylight to deal with. That's going to irritate your now sensitive eyes and harsh your mood even more, as all you crave is the sweet embrace of darkness and sleep. Halfway through day 4, your brain is going to start rebelling against whatever it is that's keeping you awake. The body simply can't survive for long without sleep, and if you aren't getting it, then your brain will take it where it can. This is when you're likely to start experiencing the phenomenon known as micro-naps. As you sit down for a moment, completely out of your own control and awareness, your brain is going to start briefly shutting down for seconds to a full minute or two at a time. The brain is entering sleep starvation, and it's going to try to fix this any way it can. Micro-naps can happen anywhere that the brain isn't being taxed by having to perform concentration-intensive duties, like talking, reading, or, God forbid, driving. Seriously, don't drive, because at this point, you are nearly as impaired as a drunk person. Day 5. Things are becoming critical. Your mood is at the lowest it can get. Deep depression has likely already set in. Bad mental health can actually make the effects of sleep deprivation even worse, especially at night when natural dopamine production slows down dramatically. You might start to get some very negative thoughts or turn to some extreme measures for sleep, like alcohol or drugs. But if there is something wrong with your brain preventing you from sleeping, these things are only going to make the condition worse, not better. Taking melatonin while unable to sleep only makes the restlessness even worse. Now you're awake and you feel even more like a zombie than normal. A terrible feeling. Micro naps are getting more common by day 5 and start happening even when your brain is in active mode. Things like driving and even walking become extremely perilous, as your brain will start to regularly shut down in order to rest. A 30-second micro nap behind the wheel of a vehicle is a good way to get the rest that you crave permanently. Your brain starts shutting down higher-order thinking when performing routine or low-attention tasks. You might go for a walk around the block and realize that you completed the entire loop with zero actual awareness. You would think that these micro-naps and dissociative states might start to make you feel a little better, but they don't. That's because your brain isn't getting the right kind of rest. To properly rest, you need to enter a deep stage of sleep known as stage 3, or slow-wave sleep. This stage is where your brain activity slows down dramatically, allowing your brain to rest and your body to initiate needed cellular repairs. In fact, you're probably noticing that even minor cuts and scrapes aren't healing properly. And that's because sleep plays a very important part in even physical healing from injuries. Slow-wave sleep typically takes place earlier in the night, and it's part of non-REM or rapid eye movement. You'll naturally move between non-REM and REM sleep cycles throughout the night, typically around 4 to 5 each time you sleep. It's not well understood why this is and what role each cycle plays in the body's health. But it is known that as you age, you'll get less and less slow-wave sleep, which might play a part in aging effects on the body and brain. But you are getting no sleep cycles whatsoever, which is a disaster for your mental health and your brain. Day 6. By day 6, your brain is so exhausted it is literally playing tricks on you. Audio and video hallucinations are frequent at this stage of sleep deprivation, either as a result of misreading sensory input or straight-up mental hallucinations. These are typically extremely brief, like catching a glimpse of a person out of the corner of your eye or hearing a short tone or a sound. However, as you continue to be denied sleep, they become more frequent. You are now just over halfway to the longest verified record for someone with no sleep. In 1964, high schooler Randy Gardner went 11 days without sleep for a high school science fair project. His effort was monitored by Dr. William Dement, a Stanford University sleep researcher. Randy experienced severe mood swings, hallucinations, increasing bouts of paranoia, and severe motor and cognitive impairment. You are no doubt starting to notice both paranoia and motor and cognitive impairment. Tasks that were routine or easy for you now require extreme levels of concentration and can only be performed slowly and methodically. Things like basic arithmetic become difficult enough to take serious concentration, even if in your normal life you were a math whiz. Your brain is slowing down and having trouble keeping your thinking straight. The badly needed repair and maintenance process for your synapses and neural pathways aren't taking place, making recalling or storing new information increasingly impossible. Soon your memory is going to be affected to the point that you may not be able to tell if an experience you think you had was ever really real at all. False memories can also be created, and if sleep deprivation continues from here, it might become real enough to be difficult to discredit. Your immune system is now dangerously weakened, and you're prone to illnesses you would have once shrugged off. If being sleep deprived isn't bad enough, try dealing with sleep deprivation and a case of the flu. Minor pains and aches are magnified as your body's natural anti-inflammation and pain relief processes are sabotaged or greatly weakened. By this point, most people will collapse from sheer exhaustion as their brain forces them to sleep. However, with a strong will, certain injuries or illnesses, or the use of stimulants, you can continue powering through. Anecdotal evidence claims that people have gone as far as almost 3 weeks with the use of amphetamines or other stimulants, but this is unlikely to be completely true. What was observed during the Randy Gardner study is that the brain starts to force increasing microsleeps and dissociative states in order to rest. In fact, nobody tracks just how long a human can go without sleeping anymore because of the serious health risks involved. Well, nobody except maybe the CIA. The agency is infamous for using sleep deprivation as an enhanced interrogation technique. Given the cognitive breakdown, heightened suggestibility, and eventual disassociation that come with prolonged sleeplessness, it's likely they've exploited just how far this method can go. But if they did, it probably proved futile. Sleep deprivation promises to lower a subject's resistance to interrogation, and disassociative states can be exploited by clever psychologists to extract information. But the value of that information is likely to be extremely low because as you end your first week of sleep deprivation, your ability to make sense is very compromised. Once more, turning to the Randy Gardner study, he was reported to speak nonsense and gibberish in response to pointed questions halfway through his sleep deprivation. Nobody knows what happens if you enter 2 weeks of no sleep without the aid of stimulants, because no public scientific study has ever pushed the boundaries that far. Some believe that permanent harm is inevitable, though it's important to note that Randy Gardner recovered to full capacity after a particularly long sleep. Psychosis and other mental illnesses are known to have a higher rate of incidence amongst people who track poor sleep for extremely long periods of time. So it's a good bet that if you go over 2 weeks with no sleep, you're at a serious risk of developing a significant mental illness. But the increasing levels of toxicity in your brain, followed by the total disruption of your body's maintenance and healing cycles, also means that death is just as likely. The situation is so dangerous that the Guinness Book of World Records no longer tracks longest attempts to go without sleeping. As week 3 starts, you're now a pioneer on the frontier of either death or madness, likely completely incomprehensible to others and yourself. A husk of a person, your brain is forcing you into increasing microsleeps and losses of consciousness. Yet if you persist without sleep, death is certainly inevitable. Think you understand how sleep works? You might want to think again. Watch Everything You Know About Sleep is Wrong to uncover the truth, or click on this video instead.